Police have chased the suspect with a knife, but there's a large crowd down there.
To my JV bag, please try me. Spill your cap in soon, now you're Siamese. Everybody move to the front like Stampede. When I didn't have an axe, I'd have Stanley.
You know what the talk is.
Whip it, set it, flick it, chef it. Cop it, chop it, press it. Cop it, lock it, sell it. Rob it, fly it, drop it, dry it. It's there on demand, I supply it. You know the coke ain't dying. You know to the gun then bust. Lean with a gun like Ross. No one ain't dying, they're lying on us. No carb in the yard and I'm flying at dust. Trust, no loyalty.
My name is Liam Brolin. I'm a lecturer in criminology at Birmingham City University. I think if you look at the statistics, we will see that actually knife crime affects people of all ages. Predominantly, it is an issue that affects young people, I would say, between 18 and 24, 25. It is an issue that affects people from all walks of life, I think, and we need to be mindful of that, that young people, regardless of race, of ethnicity, of background, or of age, can at some point be affected by knife crime. And there is no sort of single reason as to why somebody might choose to carry a knife. But I think one thing that constantly comes back into light is this idea of fear, and that there is amongst young people a perception that in order to safeguard themselves on the street, they need to use or at least carry a knife. So I think fear plays quite an important part in that decision.
Yeah, my name's Ron Winch. I'm a senior teaching fellow in policing at Birmingham City University. Yeah, well, I think in terms of ethnicity, those figures aren't widely available. You'd have to look at a freedom of information request for policing to get those figures. And I'm not sure it's altogether particularly helpful looking at ethnicity in relation to knife crime. I think there are some consistencies around, particularly around age, around the 15 to 25 age group. We know those particular age groups are particularly vulnerable to knife crime or the potential for knife crime. And I also think it's about opportunity, it's about deprivation, it's about inner city areas. But I'd say that for us to make generalisations around perpetrators and victims of knife crime can lead us into some areas of inaccuracy. So I'd rather focus on some general issues around prevention and deterrence of knife crime around that age, around that impressionable age group of 15 to 25 year olds.
I think when we talk about the relationship between education and crime, one of the things that it's important for us to consider is the point at which somebody is removed from the school system. So if you are excluded from school, it is much more likely that subsequently you will be involved in criminality and likely to end up in prison. So I think we need to think seriously about some of the alternatives that might be available to simply excluding people from school, because we know from statistics that that can be the start of a downward spiral.
Yeah, absolutely, in terms of education and employment, but also in terms of housing, in terms of, you know, lots of those social and economic aspects that we know make a difference, that can transform lives. I think there's also an issue around an area of work that we understand as what's known as adverse childhood experiences. So we know that people who, as children, you know, suffer, come from maybe dysfunctional families where there's maybe drug and alcohol abuse, domestic violence and abuse, other areas of criminality, that these can contribute to low expectations, low confidence and low aspiration in people. And I think what we need to do is we need to target individual groups, target age demographics within, you know, areas of high deprivation, and really stimulate and develop from the private, the public and the voluntary sectors, those organisations that support people and can draw them out of that cycle of criminality. And knife crime is an aspect of that.
Made them go swimming. Beyblading Jojo Lair. let it rip. Talk, come on in, get touched. Carry on chatting, splash, I love it. Do it in public, squat and tug. Ay, all of them galley on us. All us, cat. And the other side, Brock. Whoosh on me like Teddy, done, dada. Teddy, Brock, ay. Talk, come on in, get touched.
Carry on chatting,
splash, I love it. Do it in public, squat and tug.
Man,
all of them galley on us.
All of them cat.
And the other side, Brock. Whoosh on me like Teddy, done, dada. Teddy, Brock.
Brock, shot.
In relation to whether or not grime music and drill music glamorizes youth violence, I would probably disagree with that. I think that grime music and drill music provides a platform for some of these young people to express themselves. And that has long been the case with music. It has provided an opportunity for people to share their lived experiences. And I don't think grime music or drill music is any different. However, I can see the other side of the argument. Particularly if you look at the lyrical content of drill music, I do understand why some people might think that that glorifies or promotes violence. So I do think it is a fine line, but I think it's important not to focus too heavily on the role of drill music. It certainly wouldn't be a primary cause, I think, of this violence that we're seeing.
Well, I think there's certainly, whether you know, we should be looking to the world of the arts around, you know, being drivers for crime, I think we need to be very careful about. But I do think there is an issue for us to understand that there are certain social media platforms out there where we've got evidence, again, this aspect of going where the evidence takes you, where you've got criminal groups and you've got, you know, street gangs and organised crime groups potentially going onto social media platforms through music and through the arts. Taunting and disrespecting other groups and provoking perhaps a response deliberately so.
I never DM'd you for shit, my brother. That's probably a fake account, brother. That's probably a fake account. I just accepted your following.
And that then that response being manifested in crime and knife crime is an area that we can't ignore. But, you know, for me it's also about how we regulate, you know, all these spaces on these online spaces that hitherto have been sort of pretty much unregulated, and seems that, you know, it's been described as the Wild West almost around what happens online. I think we need to move into an area where we need to understand the harm and the potential harm that can be generated online. And that's through education, that's through intervention, yes, it's through regulation, it's through acts of parliament and you know, using the law. But I think in terms of politicians saying we need to be careful, because if you think about it, if you look at the average Shakespeare play, it's full of violence. So, you know, are we saying that we shouldn't be putting on Shakespeare plays because it could generate knife crime? I think we need to be very careful about the way we use the arts and fiction and bring that into real life and draw comparisons.
Hello? Yeah, what's the matter, sir?
Sorry?
Why am I being detained? Why am I being detained, sir?
There's a Section 60 in place in the city of Westminster. Can you just turn it off for me?
No, I'm not obliged to, sir. I can film in a public place. We're in a public... Well, actually, I'm on private property. Let me step off.
Just stand there. So you're being detained. I'm Peter Longworth from the TSG in Clapham. Show number 5306. You've been detained under Section 60, which is in this area.
Yeah, I understand.
It's been authorised by Superintendent... Johnson, now turn that off.
Thank you.
I don't have to turn
it off.
I don't have to turn it off, sir.
Are you pointing this at somebody?
You're violating my rights.
You're
damaging my camera. What the fuck? You're damaging my camera. I'm not resisting. You know what?
Yeah, well, Section 60 is under Section 60 of the Criminal Justice and Public Order Act 1994, and that basically authorises an officer of senior rank, and this is where... some of the powers that are given to the police have what's known as a pseudo-judicial process, where a senior officer who's independent of the operation, as it were, can look at the evidence that's provided in support of some analytical work that's conducted and be able to say, yes, actually, I've got reason to think there are going to be outbreaks of violence, of weapons, and therefore I'm happy within a given area to authorise for a specific period of time in writing that officers in uniform can stop and search people without having reasonable grounds under the Police and Criminal Evidence.
Recently, however, the government are behind the police use of stop and search, as far as I'm aware. Okay, so they have clearly given additional Section 60 powers. So as far as I'm aware, the Prime Minister and indeed the Home Secretary, Sajid Javid, has said that the police can use Section 60 powers now to stop and search people without reasonable grounds to suspect of their involvement in an offence.
The whole of Birmingham, for example, was designated as a Section 60 area, which is a very large area, controversial, needs to be regularly revisited and subject to transparency and subject to challenge potentially. So the officers and the police need to absolutely get this right. But it's, for me, it's how they consult with the community around generating community support and trust and confidence for this particular tactic. And West Midlands Police, in actual fact, were quite proactive around publicising what they were doing online and through social media, etc., and speaking to key community leaders around what the police were doing, and then generating some of the outcomes and some of the results of stop and search operations. And if you go online and you look at Twitter and social media, you'll see regular updates from West Midlands Police around operations that they're conducting, knives that they're seizing, arrests that are being made, outcomes around sentencing of criminals for carrying weapons. But that's only part of the story. That's an important part of the story. But in terms of the long-term picture, I come back to this fact about working in collaboration with other partner agencies to actually start to generate a reduction through prevention, through deterrence, through education and opportunities for the future, particularly around that 15 to 25 age group.
Even though we're criminologists, it's hard for us to see into the future, right? But I think the earlier you can intervene in a young person's life, the earlier you can demonstrate to them that there are alternatives to crime, that there are alternative ways of managing emotion, of dealing with conflict, the better.
Where the opportunities really lie is around artificial intelligence and predictive analysis. For example, if you think about developing programs and algorithms to predict actually who is going to be vulnerable from criminality in the future, then you start to be able to work in the long term. Now, some of that stuff is controversial. For example, if you had an algorithm that looked at data and examined, millions, are we talking about millions of lines of data from policing, from health, from education, etc., etc., and the police then all of a sudden knocked on the door of a single mother who had a five-year-old kid, and they said, you know what, in 5 years' time or 10 years' time, your five-year-old is going to be either vulnerable to carrying a knife or vulnerable to being a victim of knife crime. Are we criminalising, are we marginalising that vulnerable family from a very early age, and identifying through the best of intentions that actually we're saying your child is going to grow up and be a criminal? Now, what response is that sort of single mother, maybe struggling, going to, what sort of response is that going to generate? But that's the debate we need to have in relation to the development, and that's how precise and accurate artificial intelligence, I think, can be in the future. Now, how police do that, I mean, it's almost like the Tom Cruise film, isn't it, Minority Report, if you've ever seen that film, where Tom Cruise is a detective and predictions, and he goes and arrests murderers in the future before they commit murder. And really, that kind of is in the realms of science fiction, but I'm convinced that in a few years' time, we're gonna see artificial intelligence getting so sophisticated that we'll be able to make those kind of predictions. And we need to be able to, as a society, recognize how we're going to use that and manage it. And then come back to this aspect around, it's not what the police do, it's how they do it. So it's the support that single mum gets. It's the support that the authorities are able to give in terms of education, in terms of diversion, in terms of life opportunities, to make sure that 5-year-old kid isn't in 10, 15 years' time going to become a victim or a perpetrator of serious crime.
So clearly none of us can look into the future to see what is going to happen in relation to the levels of violent crime on the street I think it is important for us now to take a proactive, holistic approach to the issue, and hopefully we will see in other parts of the country the success that has been founded in places like Glasgow in relation to the approach that they've taken to serious violent crime.
Brown sugar never been so sweet, but vanilla ice cream is my favourite dish. Black of the berry, the sweet of the drip. Make a cheesecake, last bit, we can split it. Why you care what my pigment is? Held me down, I was progressing. Reminded me that my skin tone's rich. LOL, slow tighten fits. Primitive with your naughty ways. Kamikaze put me in.